This is the men's room.
Forget it, man, and get with the countdown. Shake this square world and blast off for Kicksville. Kicksville. The trippers, the grasshoppers, the hip ones, all gathered in secrecy and flying high as a kite.
You're listening to the men's room with Miles and Thrill.
Our question was
boner.
What was on or in the water? 844-999-0. Do we still have D on the line?
Still have D on the line. All right, D, welcome back to the show.
All right, back to Columbia we go. So what were you saying now?
Okay, so we in the patrol, we start making our shields, our regular shields in the day, and that day, so raining, so monkey and everything. So on the side, saying, okay, guys, we're going to start walking all day. We're going to find something, and we're going to burn it out. Okay, fine. Everybody, black it out. Great. Start walking and walking and walking, and that day, raining. So we find a little river. All of us to the types, everybody, we are very short guys. We are not very taller. So almost 5'4", 5'6", is the tallest. So we start, we sent to for safe area.
That makes sense. I don't really know too much about the Columbia basketball team.
Oh, that's a strong point, man.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Continue. Sorry, okay.
Yeah.
So, okay. So we start closing. One of my guys start shaking. I say, "Hey, do I have a chance or whatever?" So when his eyes start turning back, so there is an electric eel in the water. Father, we have an electric eel. And everybody started grabbing his guy and took it off. And we, you know, a pack full of electric eels and that little razor.
So he's standing in the river and the electric eels fire up and they're just frying his ass.
Yes, a lot.
How many of them are there?
Oh, man.
This guy is a hundred. Because
it's
the season.
What do you do? Are they freshwater or are they saltwater? I guess they're freshwater if they're in a river.
Right. It's just water.
Hmm.
But, I mean, what do you do for your buddy? Because, like, I'm not stepping in the water if that's going to get me electrocuted. Do you just kind of wait for them to finish?
No, they're stopping because he's just stopping in one. And he's stopping in one, and he started walking more. He's stopping in more. So we grab his harness and pull it out.
Okay.
So, go ahead.
Yeah, see, I don't know much about electric eels.
Can you eat an electric eel?
I don't think
it is. Is this unagi?
Maybe you could.
Dude. Look at what he's talking about. Holy hell. It says...
Wow.
All right. That's a... Okay.
That's bigger than I thought it
was. Yeah, totally.
God damn.
Man, that's a big-ass eel.
Eels are ugly.
You know,
dude.
It kind of looks like a moray eel. All right, wow.
I mean, all eels are pretty ugly.
Yeah, there's not... Like, what's the best-looking eel of the eel world?
The one that's in my mouth at dinner? Eel tastes good, but I have trouble eating it sometimes just because I know what it looks like.
That is problematic,
man. You
know
what, man? Should feel better about it, knowing what these things look like.
Why? Because it's ugly?
Yeah, pretty much. Right. Just because, like,
it doesn't tug at your heartstrings.
One less one of those is okay. It's like the goose. What was on or in the water? 844-999-OLA.
Hello, Matt. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola!
Hola!
So, spent a couple years in Louisiana when I was younger. And we went to a little place called Cameron Bay, about a mile and a quarter sidewalk through the swamps. And a lot of guys did some crabbing off the side. So some guys are sitting there with their fishing line and a 5-gallon bucket. And these guys are like, "Hey, you and your brother, come over here. Check this out." So my brother and I walk over there. And my dad's like, "Yeah, it's fine." And they slowly start pulling up their crab line. And up pops this alligator. His head's about 3 foot wide.
Wide?
Wide. It's like a 16, 18-foot alligator.
His head was
2.5 foot wide.
Why did they want you to see that? Because they knew it was in there and it was fun to play with?
Oh, yeah. They just wanted to scare the crap out of us.
Did it work?
No, it actually scared the crap out of him because once it surfaced, it decided, I want to go back down to the bottom. He still had his hands around the wire, and it tried to pull him back in. It took four of his buddies to grab him, so it didn't take him under.
How long did that struggle go on? I mean, is it, like, real quick? Does it take 10 seconds?
It took about 2.5-3 minutes for him to get it up off the bottom to the surface, and it took him about 15 seconds to let go of the line when it started taking him down.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to be anywhere near. If you knew that thing was in 100 yards of you.
Especially that
big. It's just like anything else, whether it be a bear, something that could end your life quickly. Uh-huh. And if you knew that you were in a radius, you would leave the area, right?
If you knew
that you were in a place where people were shooting guns, you know what I mean? Like, you would never walk behind a target range. Like, you would never put yourself in a position to, you know what I mean? Like, that, to me, you're just asking for it. And it's not worth the crab. I mean, it's just not. I mean, F the crab. Like, the crab's delicious, but just go find another hole. We know this.
But the other thing,
you're throwing pieces of chicken.
But that wasn't the problem. The problem was the gators that was attached to the whole crab thing. So my thought is just this. It's fine to go crabbing there, but where I stop is just, hey, there's a gator attached to it, so what I'm going to do is let the gator have it.
Sure. Not only that, but you need a trap, because in that kind of situation, like, all right, if I get a string, and this is the way I crab, at least in that situation, right, chicken bone, something. And
well, you start a string, you get a net, right. You get close enough, you scoop the crabs out.
Well, you can't be throwing chicken pieces into a swamp with 16-foot alligators. That doesn't make any sense. It's just like, you know what I mean? It's like,
no, I agree, man.
Why don't you just, you know, like, have a dead cow that you gut dragging from the back of your boat and go swimming in shark-infested waters, you know? To me, it's the same thing. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I think they're just playing the averages. Like, I mean, generally, people go down there and crab and don't get gators.
And these are swamp dudes, man.
All right.
You know,
you can.
Yeah,
I've been dealing with gators my whole life,
you can,
boy.
You can crab with a trap. You know, what I mean? You don't have to go out there with it.
But I'm just saying,
not fun,
right? I think sometimes just the nature of where you grew up predicts what you'll do. Right, okay. It's like people in the Northwest, frankly, will go climb a lot of crazy mountains that people in the rest of the country will be like,
even when it's raining outside.
Right, like, you know what I mean? Like, right, like,
that's fine.
Right, well, go camping when it's raining. Like, why?
Right.
Right. So those guys are just like, oh, the hell with it. Let's get some crabs.
That's a game.
What was on or in the water? 844-999 Ola.
Hello, Lily. Welcome to the men's room.
Ola.
Ola.
So my mom is a very smart lady. She's raised five kids. She homeschooled my brother and I, and she does really dumb things sometimes. She brought home two Siamese fighting fish. She rescued them from her work because they were going to get flushed down the toilet. She thought that was inhumane because they were alive, because she's a hippie, I guess.
How big are Siamese fighting fish?
Huh?
How big are Siamese fighting fish?
They aren't that big. They're about the size of goldfish, except they're skinny.
Okay.
Is this like a beta?
Yeah, a beta fish. It's another name.
Oh, okay. Well, come on, man.
No, Siamese, man. Like, come on. It's a freaking beta.
Just say a beta.
Jesus Christ.
No, stick with that. That's not a cool the way
no,
she said it.
But now I'm like, now you understand what it is. Now it's a little dumb thing in a ball jar. Living alone because it's an ass. You know what it is? It's like, you know, like that's crotchety uncle.
Yeah, basically. That's why you live alone.
He lives alone in a trailer. You know, beta.
Siamese fighting fish. Don't try to make them sound cool.
Yeah, right.
We know what it is. All right, so she brings them both home so they don't get flushed out of the toilet.
Yeah, and so she brings them home in the same cup. And
Two fish, one cup?
It all comes back.
Yeah, and so my brother and I were 10 and 7 at the time. I was 10. And so she brought them home, and we're like, yay, fish. But very soon after they got home, they started ripping each other apart.
Mm-hmm.
It was terrible.
Yeah, what do they do? I mean, at the pet store, there's a reason that they're the only fish all by themselves.
But do they go after each other's fins? Like, what's their mode of attack? And is it instant? Like, as soon as they see each other?
Yeah. So I don't know if you've ever ridden to like Petco or something, and they keep them in little jars.
Yeah, I mean, I know why they're separated, but I thought maybe it takes a day for them to hate each other. I didn't realize it was this instant thing.
No, they can't be around each other.
I mean, they survived the car ride home, but they didn't start fighting until they got home. So,
you know, I will say, oh boy, that's the right way to put this. My buddy. My buddy used to
be bad.
No, not really. I used to have what's called a clown knife. Do you know what a clown knife is?
Clown knife. Oh, the fish. Yeah,
a clown knife. I honestly was picturing a knife.
I keep a knife just to kill clowns.
I know what a clown knife is.
It's like
a poop knife. You know what I mean?
It's just sharper and longer.
So the clown knife, it's got kind of a hook head, and man, they really, really like to eat other fish.
Okay.
Well, I have a buddy at the time when I had the, and I bought it from him because he works at a pet store. And so the whole tank set up, you know what I mean? I got hooked up, and this is, I'm 20, 22 years old. And there was a time where they were supposed to get a lot of goldfish in, and for whatever reason, they didn't get the shipment into these goldfish. You know, no big deal. He's going to bring me probably some, what they call neons, a little fish. I'm going to feed my fish, take care of it. It turns out that cost-effective-wise, he couldn't do that. So he brought home for me to feed my clown knife betta fish, which are, you know, which are like
Siamese fighting fish?
Yes, the Siamese fighting
fish. He brought fighting fish home to feed to another fish that's going to attack other fish.
I've never seen that clown knife hit that thing so fast, man. I mean, it would normally give the other fish a chance and eyeball it. Man, as soon as that thing hit the water, it was like, bam. Matter of fact, that was its preferred food after that. And they weren't that expensive. No, betas weren't that expensive.
How much more did you spend on a beta than a goldfish? Since you were taking care of
it. They were like, you know, 50 cents, fish? A quarter fish. Yeah, they were always like a dollar. Fish. I mean, we were our kids. You know, they were
from the streets of Siam.
Yes, exactly. But man, I'll tell you what. There was nothing better than getting high and feeding that thing.
Nothing better.
It's kind of like my other buddy had a snake. So that was always a good, feeding day was always fun.
What kind of snake?
Boa constrictor. So you had mice and you had, you know.
I couldn't watch the snakes eat, but my buddy had a caiman. We'd watch that eat.
And what do they eat? Mice too?
Yeah, I told you that you got a little floating square, the mouse sits on it, and he runs around like a maniac, right?
Yeah,
and the
caiman, he's
but the caiman just sits kind of under the water and looks at him, and then that mouse for 2 seconds will pause, and the caiman eats him.
You know what's the weirdest thing about that experience? And you never really realized it. You know the little container with a handle on it that you get like with a Happy Meal? That's only other used for bait mice, like that whole packaging thing. Like if you ever see somebody walking with that thing with a handle. They've either got a Happy Meal or they've got
a snake at home.
Yeah, it's true. What was on or in the water? 844-999-OLA. Let's see. Ryan Castle coming up. The Drunken Charge Wheel. Sit and spin the 10 saddest songs in Disney movie history. That is on the way next. You are listening to the Men's Room Radio Network.
Welcome back to the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
What was on or in the water? And here come those emails in the Men's Room at mensroomlive.com.
You've got
From today, unless you have any comments there. Men's Room, I once took my son on a Disney World vacation to Orlando.
Orlando.
It was a trip the nightmares are made of. The owner of the hotel deleted all Priceline reservations and resold the rooms. Then we had to call Priceline at 11 at night to their call center in a foreign country to find a new hotel. Well, they finally found one, and it was a very fancy brand new resort, but it was way out in the middle of nowhere, so we decided to go there and then use the pool and the hot tub as there were very few people at this resort. We're having a good time. My son's about 8 at the time. I was scooping leaves out of the hot tub. There was a stick over by the edge, so I scooped it up just to realize it was human feces. It was a turd. I don't think I've ever spent so much time scrubbing myself in a hotel shower before in my life and scrubbing my son. And I swear that the smell was stuck on my hand for a week. To top it off, we were bumped from 2 flights with mechanical issues and had to spend the night sleeping in the airport. That's from Mom of the Year, Monica.
Yeah. That's a bad day.
Easiest Pie Guys, this did not happen to me. It happened to my uncle. He was scuba diving in Aruba or Jamaica or Kokomo or somewhere. I don't remember. All I know is that he went there fast and that he took it slow. Anyway, while he was there in the water, he didn't see the barracuda that came for him and bit his right nipple off. No joke. Call him Uncle Nip now. That from Sir Jolly Joe. Those things are crazy, man. You see them in the water, man. I remember they freaked me out as kids.
Well, they're big, ugly fish, man.
They swim in 2 or 3s. They got these big-ass teeth. All right, let's move on to the birthday request here. Guys, it is my 23rd birthday. Can I get a little turtle wax with a what the hell is that, bro, in the paws? Thanks, guys. That from the lovely Tasha.
Oh, my God. What the f*** is that, bro? Holy Jay.
Bitches, love your guys' show. Always puts a smile on my face. Today, my lovely wife, Christina, is 36. She is also a big fan of the Men's Room and loves you guys and loves your beer. Could she get the Dirty Germans talking to her about anything they want? Thanks a lot, you guys, and Wobbin Rock, that from Michael.
Yeah, let's talk about artwork, because I want to treat you like a painting and nail you against the wall.
Yeah, I want to treat you like a carpenter. Easy to nail.
Cheers to surviving Red Fist Bicholas. I want to give a shout out to Tammy on her birthday. And since she is indeed a legitimate Tammy with a capital T and more than she can handle, Could she have the dirty Germans telling her what's in store for her? Rock on, Matt from Bacon.
Yeah, all you need to know is that tonight I will use your butt for a finger scrunchie.
Yeah, but at the end of this, you will enjoy a little blutwurst. It's a blood sausage.
Oh.
Ew. Yeah, it's from Bavaria.
Yeah, ladies, come get my blood sausage. Look at them line up around the block for
Blutwurst.
Veiny blood sausage.
All these ladies waiting for me now. Yeah, they wanted blood sausage.
Guys, please wish my fishy friend Paul a very happy birthday. There is a lot of fish in the sea, but he is the only fishy for me. Love your taco cat, Leslie. Can I get an original fish sandwich and some dirty, dirty Germans, please?
Fish sandwich?
Yeah, I want you to be like air leaking out of a tire and slowly go down in the middle of the night.
Yeah, I'm just impressed he has this crazy pussycat hanging around and those tacos. It's a lot happening.
Yeah. We call them slap tacos.
That is unfortunate right there, isn't it?
Yeah.
All of which, all is, I would like to wish a happy birthday to my friend Butch, pronounced old as a box of rocks. Butch likes PC gaming, so I would like the Germans to teach him how to properly turn on his computer. And if Wobbin can tell him how small his penis is in German, that'd be great. Cheers, guys. That from Nate the Great.
Yeah. I don't know how to turn on your computer, but I know how you can turn me on. Take off your pants and show me your pink blood sausage.
Yeah, PC gaming's fun, but I miss the old days when you had to go up and down and blow on them a lot.
Ja, dein Schwanz ist sehr klein.
You look so happy saying that.
I'd like to wish my husband Mike, a.k.a. Jonas, a.k.a. the killer of all eight-legged creepy crawlies in my life, a happy birthday. I'm sure he would love the dirty Germans talking about pest control. Much love and sloppy hugs from Mary Quinn and Kiera.
Yeah, I do not know much about pest control, but the flute I play is the Pied Piper. It's called the skin flute.
Yeah, I love pest control. It's a lot like me. It shoots goo into cracks.
You're so elegant.
It's kind of like a spray.
It is. Your words are almost Shakespearean.
Yeah,
the subtleties of your love, it is breathtaking.
Yeah, it has an ant problem. I love going in and out of this crack.
Never heard anyone with such poetic, romantic words.
Goo.
I shoot goo into cracks.
Hello, gentlemen. Today is my dad's birthday. I don't feel like doing the math to figure out how old he is, a.k.a. pulling out the calculator, but he's a year older. If you could say happy birthday to Mr. Steven Slagle, pronounced Slagle, with something dirty and creepy from the dirty Germans, you would move this daughter up in the favorite child rankings. Happy birthday, Dad. That from Amber, not a stripper.
Yeah, tonight I think I'm going to eat a Slagle bagel.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, when she's pulled out the calculator, does she still pray? Hey, Damba, don't put not a stripper. Makes one think she was a stripper.
Yeah.
Maybe you should say any more.
Hello, bitches. It's our friend Denise's 50-something birthday today. Can you give a, your penis is too small, and maybe have a Wobbin flirt with her in German? She likes the chicks. Thanks from the best little whorehouse in Rochester.
Ja, fröhlichen Geburtstag. Ich brauche auch keinen Schwanz.
What was the ending part there?
I don't know.
Okay.
All right, guys, here you go. Happy, happy, happy birthday. Happy, happy, happy birthday. Happy, happy, happy birthday to you, to you, to you.
Ja's a Dirty German is brought to you by Men's Room Original Sausage. Available through Uli's World Famous Sausage, mensroomlive.com, and other fine retailers. Mmm, Schweinefleisch.
I like the fact that people think of us when they remember these stories. Liquor and whores, guys. I'm from Argentina.
Okay.
My most memorable poop was at the Space Needle a couple years back. I tell everyone I know to think about it whenever they see the Space Needle. Rock on, bitches. That from Thomas. Somewhere in Argentina.
An Argentinian poop.
Ola Dinosaur's way behind on your show, but I catch up all the time with your Men's Room app there on the with the podcast. Listening while sitting in DFW, Dallas-Fort Worth?
Correct.
Okay. All right. You guys were talking about missing flights. I got here at 0700 for a 1040 flight, sat at my gate waiting. No one announced the gate change, and I missed my flight. after $150 in bar tabs and a second missed flight because there wasn't room for standby passengers. It looks like I'll make the 1830 flight. What a dumbass day. The fun part is I'm only traveling so I can drive a forklift around the college stadium for a couple hours then go home. That from John the Jumbotron guy. He goes and sets up the
Jumbotron.
$150 in bar tabs at the airport.
That's not so
like
bad.
Two rounds.
Right.
And he's driving a forklift at a college stadium.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
Feels like college football, boys.
And Ola Dinosaurs, I agree with dying on a plane being the worst way to go. When I was eight, flying back to Kansas City from Los Angeles, my pilot flew through an active cloud storm. Left wing got struck by lightning, and our plane shut off. Oxygen masks drop, lights turn off, and we nosedive to around 8,000 to 9,000 feet, which, by the way, felt like forever and a half, before the plane kicked back on and the pilot pulled us back up. Rest of the flight was smooth, though. Rock on, bitches. And from Ryan.
Oh, my God, man.
In Kansas City. Speaking of Ryan, the Ryan Castle, one and only Drunken Charges in the house. Once again, it is time to sit and spin.
Yes, friends, it's time once again for Sit and Spin. Let's gather around the old radio and listen to some swellerific new music.
Yeah.
I think we can all agree that the people who write Disney movies are jerks.
Because
the whole point of a Disney movie is to break your heart at the beginning, so by the end, you feel better than you did at the beginning, therefore in love with said Disney movie.
But normally we don't think about it in a musical way that way. Normally you think about like Bambi, you know, losing her mother at the beginning of the movie, or whoever it is that loses their parent early on. It's this
but there's
pretty,
always
pretty
songs about
it.
Right.
So there are songs throughout all Disney movies, as we know, and even in the sad parts. And these songs are sad as hell. And, you know, I don't know if you guys saw this. I saw they're doing a live-action Dumbo. They've remade the Dumbo movie.
Wow.
With a real elephant?
Yes, with a real elephant with ears that can fly. Exactly. I saw the trailer for that last week, and it like tugged at my heartstrings. Well, now, I didn't cry like a baby like Mike did when he put together this
list. He had a hard time with it.
But so I didn't remember how much I loved Dumbo as a child. Like, I hadn't thought about it you know, 35 years until I saw this trailer, and I was like, oh, my God.
Was it really that good?
I used to love that movie. It's just the nostalgia of it. So I think that's where this list is going to get everybody. You don't even know how much you love this stuff or
it's
how
but they're
deep,
sad, but
deep
they're
it
sad.
Is embedded in your psyche and your soul until you
hear it. I don't have a soul. Oh, I refuse to believe this will affect me.
Okay. Well, you have kids, so you've probably seen a lot of this stuff recently.
I hate it! Right?
So, but still, these are the
I'm
10.
I'm glad it's sad!
You'll get a different emotion.
I'm so happy that it's sad. I'm
Cry!
Sorry. Do okay, it! All right. Good!
These are the 10 saddest songs in Disney movies on Sit and Spin.
10, number 10.
Goodbye, may seem forever. Farewell is like the end. But in my heart's a memory. And there you'll always be.
The song is Goodbye May Seem Forever, and that is from The Fox and the Hound.
That's some sassy music in the back, though. I feel like I'm also, you know.
Do you guys remember the scene in the movie?
No.
Did the which one of them died?
They're friends, even though they're enemies.
The fox or the hound?
Or did they just split up?
I guess eventually the fox had to die, right?
Oh, they split up. Yeah.
One was living in an Airbnb and lost their place.
Right.
These are the 10 saddest songs in Disney movies on Sit and Spin.
Nine, number 9.
I'm inclined to believe. If we were so down, we'd up and leave. We'd up and fly if we had wings for flying. Can't you see the tears were crying?
Somebody's listening too much to Dylan.
Right, well, I was going to say, I don't remember Bob Dylan being in Robin Hood, but this is Not in Nottingham from Robin Hood. The lyrics are, can't you see the tears we're crying? Can't there be some happiness for me?
No, apparently not, brother.
Not in Nottingham.
Now, when you have a voice like this, I don't think happiness is on the table.
Hey, Robin Hood.
Are you saying you want to fornicate and give me whiskey? I still can't be a happy man when I talk like this. Oh, we're doing it.
Okay.
Sometimes you just need a good cry.
Like,
you
know, just sounds like the guy's never going to be happy. Like, no matter what. Like,
Joe fought fool.
Oh, look, fried chicken and eggs. I mean, come on, dude. Perk up a little. Right, it's not that bad. Like
a is this a relative of yours?
Oh, my goodness. These are 10 of the saddest songs in Disney movies on Sit and Spin.
Eight, number eight.
All my life I watch them as I hide up here alone. Hungry for the histories they show me. All my life I memorize their faces, knowing them as they will never know me. All my life I wonder how it feels to pass a day not above them, but part of them.
I'd like to thank Ted, Mike, and Robin for charades of the correct answer to this.
Is that what this is?
Oh, is that what it was?
I was expecting like a young...
You would think they said they're all alone.
I saw Ted bend over, man, but I had no idea, and I felt bad.
I thought it was going to be like a young...
Because I know Ted gets charades, man, and I'm like, God damn it, what is it?
It sounds like a prince with a chiseled jaw, doesn't it?
No.
Okay, that sounds good. Yeah, so that song is called Out There from the Hunchback of Notre Dame. The lyrics are, all my life, I memorize their faces, knowing them as they will never know me. All my life, I wonder how it feels to pass a day not above them.
Without the hump on my back.
But a part of them.
Oh, I guess wrong.
Damn you, scoliosis. Damn
you. He's
just
a lonely man.
One day, I could stand.
This is before they checked you for scoliosis at school.
I look like that one guy I see walking in my neighborhood all the time.
Is that the guy you punched?
His back looks like an L. These are the 10 saddest songs in Disney movies.
Leg braces.
Nope.
Don't let it make you cry. For even if I'm far away, I hold you in my heart. I sing a secret song to you.
Oh, I saw this goddamn movie. I'm like, I know this.
I don't recognize this one. I'm a little out of demo for Disney movies. It's called Coco.
Right. Listen, if you have kids my age, you saw this thing.
Not the best animated movie ever.
Well, what did it say, Shrek? It's a decent movie, man. But
what are the lyrics here?
The lyrics here from the song Remember Me are, remember me, though I have to travel far, remember me each time you hear a sad guitar.
Yeah, but here's the thing, man. The whole movie's about the fact that he's talking to dead people, right? So it's already set up from the beginning. So stop being sad. No one can die in a
movie. Everybody's already dead.
Well, they're already dead. Jesus Christ.
These are the 10 saddest songs in Disney movies.
Number six.
And when she was lonely, I was there to comfort her.
I've seen this movie too, man. I don't know what it is.
Do they get a professional to sing these songs?
You know, most.
Or is it the person that's voicing the
sometimes
part?
The but they get a lot of Broadway it does that. Yeah.
Understand, man, with Disney movies, they don't care who does the voice. It's not like they need Tom Hanks. Like it's a Disney movie. So they get like all these Broadway people so they can sing their ass off and torture parents that have to sit through this
crap.
They
do the ice thing on tour so they can take your money there, too.
That is the worst.
Sell you a dumbass flashlight.
I was going to say... All right, good. Because this is from Toy Story 2. I was like, is that a Disney movie? Because you talked about Tom Hanks.
It is now, but they were Pixar.
Right, okay, so there you go. So the lyrics are, so the years went by, I stayed the same, and she began to drift away. I was left alone.
Oh. These are the 10 saddest
songs. It's a good thing you're a toy then, huh?
In Disney movies, on Sit and
Spin. Sorry.
Got some flowers.
Five, number five.
Shut up.
Who is this?
Oh, this is from The Nightmare Before Christmas.
Just stop. Oh. Well, I didn't expect with a title like The Nightmare Before Christmas, maybe there's some dark lyrics in it.
No, it's a very uplifting movie.
Oh, is it?
Okay. Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay.
They steal Christmas, kidnap Santa Claus, put him in a bag.
Yeah, Tim Burton, known for uplifting.
Mm-hmm. Right. He's really sunshiny guy.
By the way, it says a comic came in. It says, I'm a 30-year-old man. That Coco movie made me cry like a little creepy bitch.
Why am I missing this?
I don't know. I saw it too, man.
It's because you're a cynical jaded.
I'm not. Is this touching you?
No, he's talking about me.
Ted, you're a Disney freak. Is this touching you?
I haven't seen a lot of these movies.
Yeah, I mean, oh, wait, what about this one? You
come on, it's Winnie the Pooh.
Oh.
Come out here in the dark.
He was always kind of a dope, though, man.
How is Winnie the Pooh the saddest song in a Winnie the Pooh movie? You would think Eeyore would have the sad song, right?
We haven't heard from Woody in the wild.
Still looking for his pants. Yeah, I mean, turns out he had to register as a sex offender. He walks around with no pants on, man. It's not cool. Yeah. So he's kind of laying low.
Probably watches out the window for the mailman. You know, one of those guys.
Look where I put the honey.
These are the 10 saddest songs in Disney movies on Sit and Spin. There it is.
Mike just took his headphones off in the other room.
Why?
This must be the Dumbo one.
What is this? Who dies?
This is Dumbo.
Who dies?
His mom.
Oh, right now?
That's when they tell the baby not to cry.
Oh.
I'd be so mad at my mom if the last thing she said to the dying breath was sing to me. I'd be like, for real, man?
Tell me where you hid the money.
The 10 saddest songs in Disney movies on Sit and Spin.
Number two.
So no lyrics here. All you need to know is this is the sequence in Up where they go through their great lives together and then she dies at the end of it.
Oh.
Basically the beginning of that movie, which, by the way, Disney formula.
Yeah, that movie, that was a setup.
Yeah.
I'm like, I don't want to watch this stupid movie. Ah, damn, his wife died, man.
These are the 10 saddest songs in Disney movies.
Like 2 minutes in.
This is why he's so
angry. You didn't give it a chance, man.
This
damn.
This would be the saddest of them all right here.
One, number one.
Out among the stars I sail, way beyond the moon. In my silver ship I sail, a dream that ended too soon. Now I know exactly who.
You would think when you go to Disney World, you'd leave just sobbing.
What is this now?
This is from the first Toy Story. The lyrics are, now I know exactly who I am and what I'm here for, and I will go sailing no more. The song is I Will Go Sailing No More.
No.
But I'll make three sequels, bitch.
I disagree. I would say that Up and Dumbo.
You're ruining the mood.
I'm sorry.
You're ruining the mood.
I'm just going with the reality.
People were in the mood.
I know.
Stomped their mood out.
Robin's a little misty over here. Ted's a little misty. Mike had to take his headphones off. Us three jaded asses have no problem whatsoever.
It's like,
good.
Can we kill it and eat it? Kill. All right. I'll be over.
That's where elephant ears come from.
Thank you, Ryan Castle. We're going to drinkatoast.com of the shot of the day. What you don't need to know finds out if you're cheap or not next. You are listening to the Men's Room Radio Network.
This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
All right, coming up, we're going to drink a toast with a shot of the day, but first.
We're full of useless information, and you have far too many brain cells not to let us kill a few. So lend an ear while the Men's Room shares what you don't need to know.
All right, real quick here on what you don't need to know. We're going to find out if we're cheap or frugal. We all have friends that sometimes we go, man, oh, man, oh, man, they are cheap. In certain situations, you probably don't want to do anything with them based on if you have to spend any money or not or knowing the situation. For an example, all right, you go out to a restaurant and you need to calculate your portion of the group dinner bill.
Cheap.
You are, in fact, cheap.
Yeah.
And a new survey asks people, is this cheap or being frugal? Not leaving a tip.
Cheap.
That's exactly right. Buying generic groceries.
Frugal.
Correct. Carefully tracking how much electricity you're using.
Frugal.
Frugal is correct. Always tipping 15% regardless of how good the service was.
Cheap
is correct. And finally, diluting your hand soap with water so it'll last longer.
Frugal.
Now they're saying that's cheap.
Ah, well.
There you go with what you don't need to know. All right, Wobbin, have we made it to drinking time?
Somebody out there deserves to be recognized. And the Men's Room knows just who it is. So to you, we say, bottoms up, sailor. You're the toast of our shot of the day.
Drink time it is, and as usual, we head to the drink desk. And Steven Throwhill to find out who we're toasting.
Yes, indeed. Today we toast 27-year-old John Hennessy of Cape Coral, Florida. This is all you need to know. The cops showed up because he's in his front yard with a knife. He is chanting gibberish when the cops show up. He drops his knife. When he picks up a stick, starts swinging that at him. Eventually, they subdue him with a taser. Why are we toasting him? It should be noted he was doing all this while naked, standing in a fire.
Oh,
so we pour this booze, and we drink this booze because we think it's yummy.
Yummy.
So over the tongue and down the throat to party in our tummies. Down the hola, bitchola.
Let's get Caller 9 for Profile This, 844-999-OLA.
OLA. The shenanigans continue on the Men's Room Radio Network.